ॐ जननीं शारदां देवीं रामकृष्णं जगद्गुरुं पादपद्मे तयोश्रित्वा प्रणमामि मुहुर्मुहुः। इन अवर लास्ट क्लास आई ब्रीफली टॉक्ड अबाउट द क्वालिटीज ऑफ द डिवाइन मदर। व्हाई? बिकॉज हिंदूज take a very special pride in worshipping God as mother, and these are called motherly qualities. Even ordinary mother exhibits to an extraordinary degree these special qualities, which we would find even in the animals. That's why in the Chandi the mother is manifesting in every creature, both male as well as female, of course specially in the females. Ya devi sarva bhuteshu matru rupena samsthita. So special qualities, seven qualities, like the source or origin, the closeness, the nourishing aspect, the all equal distribution of love and complete forgiveness, leela, etc. I also talked about why in the Dashanami Sampradaya, our Ramakrishna order is part of that Shankara Sampradaya, and this Dashanami Sampradaya is, they never worship any other god or goddess excepting Saraswati, because she has to give us true knowledge. Dhiyo yonah prachodayat, and Shiva, the emperor of sannyasins, both as Yogeshwara and also Yogishwara. Then I mentioned in that Sri Ramakrishna himself worshipped the mother, holy mother, Sharada Devi, and awakened in her the divine motherhood. She was specially incarnated so that she could look after helpless children like us. What this helplessness is, I'll be talking about shortly. And then at the end of the worship, Sri Ramakrishna hymned, taking three verses from this Chandi, sarva beginning with sarva mangala mangalye, ending with sharanagata dinartha paritrana parayane. Then I mentioned that this particular book called Durga Saptashati. Saptashati means, Sapta means 707, Shati means 100. And this Durga Saptashati is a book like Gita, consists of about 700, a few more. So it is called Saptashati, Devi Mahatmyam, Chandi. It's obtained in the Markandeya Purana, and the Divine Mother's glory has been so beautifully depicted here. And then I also mentioned that in this book there are three wonderful stories as well as four most marvelous hymns. I also hinted that our Puranic stories are not cock and bull stories for the entertainment of people. They are meant to convey the deepest Vedantic truths in the simplest language possible that even children can understand. Of course, children understand the stories, they will be interested. A story not only contains a significance like Aesop's fables, Panchatantra, Balamitra, etc., but at the same time they also help us memory. Our memory is very important. Once we remember the story, then the significant symbolism behind the story also can easily be related. That is the methodology of sutra literature. Just what we call a simple sentence associated with a huge story remember the sentence and the like the body which is tied to that, you pull the tail and the whole body will come out. And so behind the stories there is deep symbolism. Also behind the stotras, deep philosophical significance is there. But before we go further, let me summarize. Let us keep these few points, four points in mind, so that with this in the background, we can try to understand the symbolism which we are going to discuss. First, God, with the help of Mahamaya, had created this entire universe. Vedanta tells us that we have all come from God. Symbolically, it's called Amrutasya Putraha, Amruta Putra. We are all children of immortality. How? Because we are created by God. And God cannot create without the help of Shakti, Yoga Maya. God cannot even incarnate without this Yoga Maya. In the Bhagavad Gita, the most marvelous philosophical, devotional, Puranic literature obtainable anywhere in this world, Bhagavan Krishna says that Prakrutim Swam Adhishthaya Sambhavami Atma Mayaya. Without Maya, there is no creation, there is no birth. So even if God has to incarnate, he has to take the help of his own Shakti. So 2 points here. One is without the help of Shakti, called in Vedantic literature Maya, called in the Puranic literature by the devotees Mahamaya, the Great Mother. Without that, it is impossible. Second, it belongs to God, Vishnu's Maya, Vishnu Maya. They are, in Sri Ramakrishna's words, inseparable. Brahman and Shakti are inseparable. And that is why in the Saundarya Lahari, Shankaracharya starts this very particular book called Saundarya Lahari. Shivaha Shaktiya Yukto Yadi Bhavati. If Shiva is separated from Shakti, not united with Shakti, then he will not exist, he will not be able to manifest, he won't be able to do his job. So also Vishnu, so also Brahma. So this, what we call in Vedanta, Ishvara, is nothing but married Brahman. Mrs. Brahman, another name for Mahamaya. Without Mrs., it is impossible to do anything. So first point is, God, with the help of Mahamaya, had created this entire universe. We are part of that universe. Therefore, we also have been created by Mahamaya. Created means she herself has become manifesting like us, as us. Second, what is this samsara, this world, universe, Vishwam, Jagat? The samsara is nothing but suffering and troubles. Tritapa we call it. Adhyatmika, Adibhautika and Adidaivika. That is why every single second we are trying, struggling to get out of this limitation. We breathe because we want to live. We eat because we want to live. And we are, our entire life, why do we want to earn money? So that we can reduce the limitations of poverty, of hunger, of housing, of dress, etc., etc. So more facility is there. So this samsara is nothing but suffering and troubles. That's what Bhagavan Buddha had summarized in one sentence. Life is full of suffering. That is one of the very first four Aryan Noble Truths. But this very samsara is the greatest vehicle for obtaining इधर धर्म और अर्थ और कर्म और द मोस्ट इम्पोर्टेंट मुक्ति मोक्ष. सो अकॉर्डिंग टू वेदांत मोक्ष इज द परम निःश्रेयस, दट इज द परम पुरुषार्थ, दट इज द सेकंड पॉइंट. संसार इज नथिंग बट ट्रबल एंड इट इज ट्रबल एक्चुअली इज ए बोन विच अवेकन्स अस एंड देन टेक्स अस टू गॉड. इफ देर हैड बीन नो सफरिंग वी वुड नेवर हैव फेल्ट द नीड फॉर प्रोग्रेसिंग. विल बी लाइक कार्पेट्स और फुट रग्स. थर्ड पॉइंट, देयरफॉर एवरी स्क्रिप्चर स्पेशली हिंदू स्क्रिप्चर्स एडवोकेट द परस्यूट ऑफ स्पिरिचुअल लाइफ, दैट इज कॉल्ड मोक्ष. फोर्थ पॉइंट, फॉर अटेनिंग मोक्ष वी नीड द ग्रेस ऑफ गॉड, बट द ग्रेस ऑफ गॉड कैन बी ऑब्टेन्ड ओनली बाय द ग्रेस ऑफ द डिवाइन मदर हु इज द क्रिएटर सस्टेनर एंड डिस्ट्रॉयर ऑफ दिस यूनिवर्स. सृष्टि स्थिति विनाशानाम शक्तिभूते सनातने गुणाश्रये गुणमयि नारायणि नमोस्तुते. इफ वी अंडरस्टैंड दीज फोर एसेंशियल पॉइंट्स देन वी हैव अंडरस्टूड द एंटायर समरी ऑफ एवरी स्क्रिप्चर इन दिस वर्ल्ड. कमिंग बैक, द सेम पॉइंट अप्लाइज टू दिस देवी महात्म्यम दुर्गा सप्तशती. Those four points in this book specifically called Chandi, Durga Saptashati, Devi Mahatmyam. Three names but one book. There are three stories and four hymns of incomparable beauty, not only beauty but the deepest philosophy. Now I will be talking about the inner symbolism of these three important stories, not in this particular talk only but slowly. But in this particular today's talk I will talk about the story, the background of the story, the first story of Madhu and Kaitava and the inner symbolism of this one. So let me start first of all with the background, how the Chandi starts. So there was first of all, this Chandi, Devi Mahatmya, is divided into three parts by the book itself. Prathama Charitra, first story, then Madhyama Charitra, second story, then Uttama Charitra, the third story or last story. Okay, and then there must be a background, and that is what very briefly I will discuss, and I will also in between insert the most interesting meaningful remarks about it. The story starts like that. There was a king, his name was Suratha. He was a great king, very loving king, and he used to look upon his people, the entire kingdom, Nija Aurasaniva, as if they were born from his own body. That means like his own children. He was intelligent, he was philosophical, and he was strong. But at some point, there were some enemies. But who are the enemies? They are called Kolas, and they are called Vidvamsina, destroyers. Like the army of Genghis Khan, whatever comes on their path, they burn, butcher, kill, destroy, and then make the earth a living hell. They conquered this king, and slowly they penetrated into the kingdom. And then the people are so ungrateful. Many of them, his ministers, his close relatives, including his own family members, joined those. That is why he say, Bhagavan Shankaracharya in his Bhaja Govindam Stotram, Yavat Pitto Parjana Sakta Tavat Anurakta. A family will be inquiring after us only so long we are capable of providing them, nourishing them, looking after them. The moment we become old, Kopina Pruchati वार्तागे नोबडी इंक्वायर्स अबाउट इट दिस इज अ वेरी कॉमन एक्सपीरियंस इफ दे डू नॉट थ्रो अस आउट देन वी आर वेरी फॉर्चुनेट लेट अस से दैट वन सो दिस किंग had been literally kicked out of his kingdom and then he had no option but to run into a deep forest and there was a great sage called Sumedha and he took shelter in the ashrama as a guest but the real conversation did not take place the king was brooding over how his fate has changed overnight but Something strange was happening. The king was thinking. Now, as I said, now and then I will give you also that there is the background history from the very book itself. Swaro Cheshe Antare Purvam Chaitra Vamsha Samudbhavaha Suratho Nama Raja Abhut Samaste Kshiti Mandale. The great king, he was born of the Chaitra Vamsha His name was Suratha. Then what did he do? Tasya palayata samyak prajaha putran iva aurasan. As if all the people of his kingdom equally like his own children. Then what happened? His ministers, everybody as I mentioned, joined the more powerful enemy. And then he entered into the ashrama. Of Sumedha, who was a great sage, and then sometime he stayed there. Then, but the brooding, what happened to him, did not disappear from his mouth. So, in Chintayata, tada tatra mamatva akrishta manasaha mat purvaihi palitam purvam maya hinam puramitat. I will not quote everything, but I will give you the gist, which is most important for us. This king started brooding. Well, I loved all of them. I looked after all of them. And I have also accumulated, made the kingdom very prosperous. My treasury is full of money. What are my servants, my former ministers? Are they still looking after the kingdom? Are they simply looting the money and lining the pockets of the people? And I had a very favorite elephant. And then is someone looking after it? What is it going to be its fate? It used to love me. Now, here is the point. He knew that he was helpless. He should have hated them. You fellows, so long as I was looking after you, you were doing salam every second. The moment somebody came, You simply looked the other way, welcomed the other fellows, kicked me out. What should have been? We should have been developing vairagya towards them. I will never again think about it. But Mahamaya, again and again, he was only brooding. Why? Mamatva akrishta manasaha. His heart was completely overpowered by mamatva. What is mamatva? Terrible amount of delusion. Mine. Really, literally, it is a landmine. Anybody says mine, that is a landmine, according to Vedanta. So, this is how a beautiful description is going on. Then what happened? Few days later, another man also came running. He was a merchant. His name was Samadhi. I will explain the meanings of the words slightly later. His name was Samadhi. He was very rich person. But in his case, not the enemies, but his own family members waited enough time for this person to work hard and accumulate money. As soon as money was accumulated, this head of the family simply dragged out of his house and kicked out, literally. He had nowhere to go. He also heard about this ashrama. He came to this ashrama. He was also thinking about it. And then both of them started talking. What were they talking? They were great philosophers, but completely helpless. They were people of discrimination, but completely helpless, like any one of us. So, what was the remark I wanted to make? These stories, they are not stories to be found in the Puranas or scriptures. They are every day-to-day life that is going on here, whether it is the entire country or particular states, politicians, family members, quarrels between family members. This is endemic. This pandemic is going on everywhere in this world. So, these two, Suratha, the Raja Suratha, the king called Suratha, and then the merchant called Samadhi. Sumedha is the name of the sage. Let me explain. Suratha means a person who is well balanced physically, mentally, emotionally. A man who is not easily swayed from losing his balance is a very balanced person. And then what is the meaning of Samadhi? The Vaishya was a great devotee, greatest philosopher, and he was longing for moksha, but as a duty, he was earning money. These two people met here. And why we interpret this way? The story comes at the very end. When the time comes, I will tell you that one. So, these two people met this sage, started staying as guests. Naturally, they were introduced to each other, and naturally, they fell. Who are you? Why did you happen to come here? So, they asked each other, and then this sage's name is Sumedha. Medha means right understanding. Sumedha means absolute understanding. What does it mean? To understand logically something aright, completely in the right manner, is called Medha. But to realize the truth and know instinctively that this is the truth, that is called Sumedha. That means he was a Rishi, he knew what is the truth, he realized God. So, what is happening? These two were fell talking to each other. What were they telling? The king told his story and the merchant told his story. That's the background. But what were they taking? Why? How come that we have been thrown out by our own people, instead of hating them, instead of trying to forget them, instead of running away from them as much distance as possible? Our minds are inevitably, helplessly drawn to those very people. Our whole time is spent thinking only about their welfare. What a stupid thing. A person has deceived me and I am incapable of kicking them out of my mind. I am thinking, are they happy? Do they require something? If I am not there, will they be able to manage themselves? I would have rendered them service. This is called Mahamaya. So, this is what we are trying to do, this one here. These people are trying to make themselves, this particular thought has come into their minds. So, what were they talking about here? Soham navedmi putranam kushala akushalatmikam pravruttim svajananam cha dharanam chatrasamsitha. We are thinking about our children, our family members, whether they are happy, healthy, they are also maintaining their health properly, and how they are leading their life, how our wives are there. Kimnutesham grihe kshemam. Are they keeping very well? Everything is going on nicely. Kimno sampratam akshemam. Are they experiencing any difficulties? Katham te kimno sadvrittaha. Have they become better people now? Are they becoming worse? Dirvrukta kimnu mesuta. Then the king was asking the merchant, yaihi nirasto bhavan lubdhai putra dharadibhir dhanaihi teshu kim bhavata sneham anubadnati manasam. My friend, you have been kicked out by your own family members. Yet, you are thinking, te bhavatah sneham. It's completely bound you. Why is it? And then the merchant was replying, whatever you said is absolutely true. Then, here is the psychological truth which all of us experience. Kim karomi, I am helpless, what can I do? Na badnati mama nishturata manaha. My mind refuses to come under control and stop thinking about them. Kimetan abhijanami jananapi mahamate yat prema pravanam chittam vigunoshvapi bandhush. Bandhushu means all those people related to me, viguneshu, evil people. Then, but what is it? I know, jananapi, I know I should not think about them. I know what they have done to me, and yet, as if I am forced to think only about them. Why is it Mahamate, O most intelligent person? Then, the Muni who was narrating this story, Markandeya, Markandeya Purana, he was telling, then both of them approached this sage called Sumedha. And then what did they address him? Bhagavan Svamaham Prashtum Ichami Ekam. O Lord, we would like to, great sir, we would like to put you a question. Please reply us and make our minds understand. Dukhaya yanme manasa svachitta ayatatam vina. We are completely out of control of our minds. And then both of us, we have been kicked out. Tat kenaitan mahabhaga yan moho gnanino rapi mamasya bhavatyesha vivekandasya modhata. This is the crux of the philosophical aspect of this particular Chandi, both of them, they were questioning this great guru. He says, Tat kena etan mahabhaga, yan mohaha, gnaniro rapi. We are gnanis, intelligent people, endowed with discrimination. We know that we should not think about them. The world is like that. But yet mohaha, we are overcome by delusion, like Arjuna was overcome by delusion. Mama asyacha, both mine and as well as this king, vivekandhasya modhata, our viveka is completely covered up with darkness. Then the Rishi Sumedha is replying, my friend, you also have knowledge, all animals have knowledge, look at these birds, parent birds, they themselves are suffering from terrible hunger. And yet, day and night, they are braving so many dangers. They are gathering food to feed their shavachinchushu. Their young ones are there crying with open beaks. And these people carry whatever they can carry. And in the process, many of them die also. And yet, instead of looking after themselves, they are looking after their children. How come this is happening? It's a beautiful question that all of us have to question ourselves and say that we are also in the condition. We ourselves are suffering so much. Instead of attending to our own suffering, instead of trying to understand what are the causes of our suffering, instead of trying to remedy them, we are thinking about our husbands, our wives, our children, our friends. This is called terrible delusion. This is how the story starts. Then the Sumedha is telling that all this is because of one great universal power. That power is called Mahamaya. And then these people, they ask, great soul, Mahamedha, that you are talking, who is this Mahamaya? And how does she delude all of us? What are her glories? And please tell about us as if we don't know anything about that Mahamaya, but as if she is deluding the whole world and we are only part of that world. That is how the story of Durga, Kali, etc. comes here. So the Muni is telling, let me tell, these people, the king, he was asking, Bhagavan, Kahisa Devi, who is that Devi? Yam Bhavan, Mahamayeti Abruvan. So you told us that there is one Mahamaya. Who is this Devi? Katham Utpanna, how did she originate? Sa Karma, what does she do? O Dvija, please inform us, because we are completely ignorant. Yat Prabhava Chasa Devi, what is her glory, greatness? Yat Swarupa, what is her real nature? Yat Udbhava, where from did she originate? Tat Sarvam, everything about that Mahamaya, Shrotum Ichyami, we would like to hear from you, Tvato. And then, who are you? You are not an ordinary person. Brahmavidam Varaha. You are the greatest soul in the Brahmavidam. Among the knowers of Brahman, you are the greatest. You are Sarvajna. You know everything. We are completely ignorant people. Please tell us about this. Then the Rishi says, Nitya Ivasa Jagan Murtihi Taya Sarvamidam Tatam Tathapi Tat Samutpatti Bahudha Shruyatam Mama. This Jagan Mata, this Mahamaya is eternal. Ajo Nityaha Shashvatoyam. She is never born. She is Ajaha, unborn. She is Nityaha. She is eternal. Shashvataha. She is forever. Then, but just as Bhagavan Krishna says, Yada Yada Hi Dharmasya, whenever virtue goes down and vice is on the increase, I incarnate myself with the help of my Mahamaya, which is called Daivi Maya, which consists of Sattva, Rajas and Tamas, and then I try to balance, bring back the virtue and subdue. Subdue means even God cannot kill evil, adharma, because dharma and adharma are not two separate things. If only there were to be dharma, there would be no world. There is only good people. Tell me, how will you know who is a good person? When you see 100 bad people and then see one person, good person, this person is totally different. If you don't know what is darkness, you will not know what is light. If you don't know what is suffering, you don't know what is happiness. If you don't know what is evil, you can never recognize what is good. So it cannot be eliminated. Swami Vivekananda says, there are many people who think and are convinced, slowly we are increasing in our knowledge, and a day will come, all evil will disappear, and this world will become Svargaloka. Actually, it will become Narakaloka, because everybody is good. Good means, and everybody is dead. Only a dead person is a good person. There is some beautiful conversation. There was a nice person. One day, he was sitting in the park, and his friends saw him, joined him, sat down, and said, you know, such and such a person is praising you highly. Then the man was shocked, surprised. He said, how come I am not yet dead? Only dead people will be praised as good. No living person will ever be praised, either because of jealousy or because of ignorance. It is only evil we criticize. Rarely we get people who are appreciated. Okay, this is the background. Now, the Rishi tells how this Divine Mother, that means if we are talking about Vishnu Purana, how Vishnu, even though he is eternal, he incarnates himself for Dharma Sthapana now and then. Similarly, instead of using this, is, remember, this is about the glory of the Divine Mother, I mentioned earlier. Puranas offer three types. Those who praise and extol Vishnu, they are called Vishnu Puranas. those who extol Shiva, they are called Shiva Puranas, and those who extol Devi, they are called Devi Puranas. We have, by the way, 18 major Puranas and 18 minor Puranas. And Vyasadeva is supposed to be the author of all these 36 Puranas, Mahabharata, Bhagavatam, and of course, dividing the Vedas into four categories, etc. Now, coming back, this what Vaishnavas call incarnation of Vishnu is what Shaktas, or devotees of Divine Mother, call as the Divine Mother incarnates whenever Dharma goes up. The rise of these evil people means the rise of Adharma. Always remember, Dharma and Adharma, virtue and vice, or good and evil, have absolutely no meaning if they are not manifest in a living being. Remember, this is one of the greatest philosophical truth, Vedantic truth. A red color doesn't exist excepting in an object. You cannot separate and say, this is redness and it is an object. There is no object called redness. Redness is a visheshana, an attribute, a quality. A red flower, a red shirt, a red building, so also every quality. He is a good man if there is no such thing called goodness per se. So here, the dharma means it must manifest in a person like Yudhishthira or Harishchandra. Satya manifested in Harishchandra, in Kshudiram, etc. Similarly, adharma also cannot be found separately excepting in a person. That is why, whether it is Saddam Hussein or Hitler or Genghis Khan or this Rakshasa called Ravanasura, Kamsasura, etc., Hiranyakashipu, etc., it must manifest. So, here is the story with this background of the how the Rishi Sumedha narrates. Vishnu, Bhagavan Vishnu, created Brahma, and then he assigned him the job of creation and promptly went into Yoga Nidra. And while Vishnu was sleeping, two demons came out of the earwax, the impurity of the Vishnu. Vishnu, Karna, Mala, Udbhavau. Two have come, they were called Madhu and Kaitava. Vishnu was sleeping, they could not see the Divine Mother. They saw this Brahma. Brahma wants to create, but these asuras want to destroy. Brahma represents truth, dharma, etc. Only dharma creates, adharma always destroys. Creator means dharma. So they wanted to destroy, adharma wants to destroy dharma. And Brahma saw, and he was helpless because he was dharma. Dharma is weak in the beginning. So he saw, and then he looked at Vishnu, his creator, his protector. What was the protector doing? He himself was sleeping. Now Vishnu cannot fight with them. Even if Brahma shouts, he cannot be woken up. But Brahma knew that there is a power even beyond Vishnu, which is controlling Vishnu, which has put Vishnu to sleep. So he understood, then he started, if I want to be saved from these two, there is no way excepting obtaining the mother's grace. So he started saying hymns with all sincerity, with utmost devotion. And then very soon, Mahamaya appeared to him. And then she understood. She need not be told why Brahma was hymning. So what did she do? Ya Devi Sarva Bhuteshu Nidra Rupena Samsthita. She put Vishnu also to sleep. And then immediately Vishnu, she withdraw herself from Vishnu in the form of Nidra. That means Vishnu became awakened. And then he saw immediately these two asuras, Madhu and Kaitava. And they were about to finish up Brahma, the creative aspect of God. And Vishnu fought with them for 5,000 years, Pancha Varsha Sahasrani. And so valorous were these, after all they were his children, you know. You have to remember, even if evil people are the children of Bhagavan only, Divine Mother only. So after all they came out of his ears, and then so they were also chip of the old block, as we say, chips of the old block. They fought with their father for 5,000 years, and then they appreciated, old man, even though you are old, still you have so much of vigor, and we will give you a boon. That was also the Divine Mother deluded them, we will give you a boon. Remember, who can give a boon? Only people with extraordinary power, only God. These people were almost like God, God-like. That's why they could give. And Vishnu, being the old chip, old block, he was more intelligent because he had more experience. He said, thank you, thank you, thank you. And I only want this much. May both of you be killed by me. And then they awoken and said, what stupid fellows we are. We have, without thinking, we have given a boon. All right, but they are truthful people. They said, we'll give a boon. We have to give a boon. What did Vishnu say? Vadhyatam maya. May you both of you be killed by me. And then they put a small condition, thinking they will escape. Everywhere at that time there was waters. That's what we say. The Noah's Ark was created. The whole world is flooded. At the time of Pralaya, it will be filled with waters. Causal, of course, it is called causal waters. Karanan Jala. But we'll talk about it some other time when the occasion comes. Then they said, okay, okay, we have given the boon. We are not people to withdraw it or tell a lie. You kill us where there is no water. And then Vishnu said, looked here and there. Then he took both of them on his thighs, which is above water, and he finished them both. And then he blessed Brahma. This was not said in the book, but I think he must have gone back to his Yoga Nidra. And then Brahma started creating, and that is the end of the first story. As I mentioned, it is of deep symbolic significance. What is the significance? Who is Brahma? Who is Vishnu? Who is Mahamaya? Who are these Madhus and Kaitavas? First of all, Vishnu is what we call Nirguna Brahma. Nirguna Brahma cannot create. Therefore, he has to assign the job. He has to seek the help of Mahamaya called Shakti. Or in Advaita Vedantic literature, it is called Maya. But in Dvaitic literature, she is called Parvati, she is called Lakshmi, she is called Saraswati. That's why Brahma cannot do anything without Saraswati. What is Saraswati? Brahma's knowledge is Saraswati. What is Mahalakshmi? Okay. What is Brahma's job? Creation. That's why he doesn't have any weapons. What is the job of Vishnu? Stiti, Karana. He is the law maintainer. Therefore, he requires weapons. But weapons themselves will not do, because he has to reward people who are good, punish people or correct them with weapons. He cannot use weapons for destroying his devotees, good people. So for doing that one, even to sharpen, throw away the old weapons and buy the latest AK-47s, etc., he requires money. That's why Lakshmi is the Shakti which helps Vishnu to maintain. And then Shiva, he has to withdraw the people, give them modern dresses, new dresses. That is called Laya. And that's why he must have Trishula. Why Trishula? You destroy the physical body and give a new body. He is a good person. Destroy his evil mind, give him a new mind, spiritual mind. Finally, you destroy all his old samskaras, which is called Karana Sharira, and with one stroke, the gross, the subtle, and the causal bodies, because God doesn't deal in retail. He deals only wholesale. So all the three bodies, that means the entire delusion, Mahamaya, Samsara, Avidya, has to be destroyed with one stroke. That is why he has this Trishula, trident. It is called trident. Otherwise, if he has got one dent, then he has to separately kill, waste a lot of time. And by the time he kills one body, another body will spring like Raktabija. Okay, anyway, coming back. So, Shiva requires Kali or Parvati. Vishnu requires Lakshmi. And Brahma requires Saraswati. What is Saraswati? Shakti. What is Lakshmi? Shakti. What is Parvati or Kali? Shakti. So, what is Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva? Chaitanya. Chaitanya plus Shakti, that is the what is called creator, as creator, as sustainer, as destroyer. Ishvara is nothing but Brahman plus Shakti. So now coming back to our story, Brahma wants to do his job of creation. Creation always requires Sattvika Buddhi. Then what happened suddenly, this Mahamaya has to do both Srishti, Sthiti, Samhara. She is the both rewarding power as well as punishing power. These two demons have come. What are the two demons? Madhu and Kaitava. What is Madhu and Kaitava? Madhu means sweet, honey actually. Kaitava means what? Bitter. And they are born out of what? The ear wax. What does it mean? It means when we are crude human beings, without samskara, we are slaves of our ears. In Bengali, they call it kan patala, weak ears. W-E-A-K, weak ears. What does weak ears mean? That means somebody says, you are so beautiful, you are so intelligent, you are so great. Vandi Magadi, kings are praised. You are the greatest in this world. The same fellows, if they are not paid, they will say you are the worst fellow in the world. And the same fellows were praising his father, you are unparalleled in this world. As soon as that old man is gone, now they are praising the new one, you are the Indra, Chandra, Maheshwarites, Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesvara, etc. It is their what is called paid job. Like people, there are some people who are called paid weepers. That is, if somebody dies in a family, there is a certain caste, section of people, they don't weep themselves. If their mother, father, somebody dies, they pay money, bring these people. The more money you pay, the more strongly they weep, the longer also they weep, loudly they weep. So, these fellows, stuti, we are all slaves of stuti and ninda. Ninda and stuti. Mana and apamana. We want to hear, we are always wonderful. We never want to hear, never want to be criticized. That is called Kaitava. If somebody praises, even if we know very well, we do not possess those qualities, still we would like to hear them, we entertain them. These are called flatterers. Now what is the point? So long as we are slaves to our sense organs, ears means, remember, not merely ears, slaves to the eyes, to the ears, to the nostrils, to the tongue, and to the skin. All the enjoyments that we go through, we are slaves. Things are favorable, we are happy. Things are not favorable, we are unhappy. We are slaves to these vagaries of this mind. They represent Madhu and Kaitava. What does Brahma represent? Creative energy. What is creative? Each one of us are potentially divine. Devotee, remember, is not making a pot, is not making a house, is not writing a book, or writing a poem, or sculpting an image. It is to say, we want to bring the inherent perfection into manifestation. And of all the greatest manifestation is to know who we really are. That is the greatest creative act, to know I am this. Remember the psychological fact, only a master can manifest an infinitesimal part of his knowledge as either beautiful music or poem or literature or any scientific knowledge, etc. So, this Brahma means creativity, Brahma means Vedas, Brahma means Vedic knowledge, Brahma means that Mahavakya, Aham Brahmasmi, and we want to bring it out, but it is not coming. Spiritual knowledge is overpowered by worldly knowledge. So, how to bring about? We need the grace of Vishnu. What is Vishnu? He represents discrimination. He represents buddhi. Dhiyo yonaha prachodayat medha. But what is happening to Vishnu? That he is overpowered by tamasika nature of the Divine Mother. Nidra, sleep, belongs to the tamasika nature. But what is the way mentioned earlier? Only God's grace. In this case, who is the God? Mahamaya, the Divine Mother. So, Brahma has that much knowledge without God's grace. It's impossible for me to know who I am. So, immediately, he starts praising the Divine Mother, and Mother was highly pleased. And what does she do? She bestows the grace. What does she do? She withdraws her tamasic and rajasic powers. Sattva guna becomes awakened, improves almost 100%. And then, with that, man understands, oh, so long I have been a slave to the sense organs, to praise and blame mana, apamana, sita, ushna, jaya, apajaya, sukha, dukkha. No, the truth is, everything is God. If I am God, the whole world is God. So he becomes, by the grace of the mother, awakened, uttishtata, jagrata, prapyavara, nibodhata. And he manifests divine power. So as soon as these enemies have been killed, now what is the symbolism? You conquer us, you kill us. That means our own mind, at some point with all its powers, is the only power. If we use it for good purpose, then we progress spiritually. If we use the same energy for wrong purposes, we go down. That is the meaning of this beautiful story. You cannot kill half of your mind, but you conquer them, you kill them, you transform the evil actions, the adharmic samskaras, into dharmic samskaras. And for that, discrimination has to work. Vishnu represents that buddhi in the form of viveka, vairagya, shamadamadi shatka sampatti, and finally mumukshutvam. And as we progress in spiritual life, this very mind, which has been pulling us down so long, now it becomes our greatest helper. And that is the meaning of conquering the Madhu and Kaitava. As soon as that happens, our inner spiritual awakening takes place, uttishtata, jagrata. Then we practice spiritual discipline. Each one of us remember, each one of us is a Brahma. We want to know who we are. That is called the true activity of creation, creative activity. And then this opposition is there in the form of tamas, nidra, indulgence, laziness, wrong understanding, misconception, etc., etc. And then we need the grace of God. But ultimately, the grace of God can come only from the Divine Mother. So the lesson is, you worship the Divine Mother. As soon as you worship the Divine Mother, her grace will come. In what form? Ya Devi Sarvabhuteshu Buddhi Rupena Samsthita. Ya Devi Sarvabhuteshu Vidya Rupena Samsthita. Ya Devi Sarvabhuteshu Daya Rupena Samsthita. Ya Devi Sarvabhuteshu Chetanet Yavidhyate Viveka Vairagya Shamadamadi Shatka Sampatti. Ya Devi Sarvabhuteshu Shakti Rupena Samsthita. We need Shakti, power, strength, even to become good cook, good statesman, good president of America. We need Shakti. All these qualities will be bestowed by the Divine Mother, and that is the inner symbolism. We are all Brahmas, But we are overpowered at this moment by the old wrong negative samskaras, adharmic samskaras. We are slaves to our sense organs. The only way, take refuge in the Divine Mother, and she, out of her grace, she withdraws all our tamas and rajas. We develop our sattvika buddhi, and then viveka, vairagya, etc. will come. Then we will fulfill our mission in life, which is to know I am none other than that Divine Mother, that Parabrahma. I will conclude this speech with a few quotations from this first story itself, Prathama Charitra. The first stotra comes. It is called Brahma Stotra. Brahma hymning to the Divine Mother. How does it start? Very small, but I will discuss about it and other hymns in our future classes. Tvam Swaha, Tvam Swadha, Tvam Hi Vashatkaraha Swaratmika, Sudhatva Makshare Nitye, Tridha Matratmika Sthita. Tvam Swaha, you are the mantra called Swadha. Swaha means when we offer to the devatas, Indra Chandra, at the end we have to say Indraya Swaha, Ramakrishnaya Swaha, Krishnaya Swaha, Sharada Deviya Swaha, etc. But when we are addressing our ancestors, means, then we have to say Swadha. Tvami Vashatkaraha, when we are addressing some other deities, we have to use that word Vashatkara. Tvam Sudha, you are Amrita. Tvam Akshare, you are the imperishable. Nitye, you are the eternal. And then Arthamatra Sthita Nitya, you manifest in the form of Arthamatra. What is Arthamatra? Remember, Omkara has got four letters in it, syllables. A, O, Ma, etc. And then the fourth one is Om. Is called Ardhamatra. That is real Omkara. That is called Turiyavastha. You are that. Then Tvameva Sandhya, Savitri Tvam, you are Sandhya Devi, you are Savitri Devi, Parajanani, Parashakti, you are the Supreme Mother. Tvayaitat Dharyate Vishwam, Tvayaitat Srujyate Jagat, Tvayaitat Palyate Devi. You create this world, you maintain this world, and you also look after, sustain this world. Then he says, you are called Mahavidya, Mahamaya, Mahamedha, Mahasmruti, Mahamohacha Bhavati, Mahadevi, Maheshwari. Then, Tvam Sri, you are the Lakshmi. Tvam Ishwari, you are the Kali Parvati. Tvam Hri, you are the Divine Mother, and you are also Buddhi, Bodha Lakshana. You are Lajja, you are Modesty, you are Pushti, you are Sustenance, you are Tushti, you are Complete Satisfaction, you are Shanti, you are Peace that passeth all understanding, you are Kshanti, you are the Forbearance itself. Saumya, Saumya Tarasesha, Saumye Bhyastu Atisundari, Para Paranam Parama, Tvameva Parameshwari. Saumya, you are the sweetest, softest thing in this whole world. Not merely softest, among all the softest. Saumya Tara Asesha, Saumye Bhya. There are many soft things in this world, sweet things in this world. But of them, you get the first prize. And Sundari, you are the what Sundari? Ativa Sundari, you are the Miss Universe. And you are the Supreme, then the Supremest. Everybody, O Mother, tries to praise you, hymn you, but what power I have got? You have given me a little power. With that power only I can understand you, and with that power only I can hymn you, I can praise you. Remember Shiva Mahimna Stotram, that your glory is, O Shiva, so great. Asita Giri Samam Syat, Kajalam Shindupatre, Surataruvara Lekha, Shakhani, Patramurvi, Likati Yadi Sarada Sarvakalam, even Mother Saraswati, if she writes forever, tadapicha tava mahimna param nayati. Nobody, even Saraswati, cannot write because you are infinite. So, this is the stuti of Brahma. Mother was pleased, and this is a wonderful stuti. We can also use it. And like that, there are another three stutis, which are deep philosophically and indirectly. Why indirectly? Even directly, they tell us about our own Swarupa. If Aham Devi, if I am the Devi, then who is different from Devi? The whole world is nothing but the Divine Mother. That means we are the Ativas Mahamedha, Mahasmruti, Mahamoha, Mahamaya, Mahadurga, Mahalakshmi, Mahasaraswati. We are Buddhi. Everything that we attribute to the Divine Mother, we are that. That means we become Brahmans. We, not Brahmans, there is no plural. Aham Brahmasmi Sarvam Idam Brahmamayam. Everything is Brahman. This is the background story, how this world is mesmerized by the Divine Mother. And there are a few points, we will discuss it in our next class, because even though I take little time, and sometimes you notice I also ramble, but this every sentence is very precious. I don't waste my time, wasting my time, your time, telling something which is irrelevant. So much is there. So many ideas are rushing forward. But I have to confine myself within the time limit. So we will discuss how, as I mentioned earlier, these are not Puranic stories. These are day-to-day events that will happen in the world, that happened in the world, that will happen in the world, in each one of our lives. And how these Puranas are related directly with each one of our life stories, how we can only get out of this limitation through Mahamaya's grace. This we will discuss in our next classes. Om Jananim Sharadam Devim Ramakrishnam Jagatgurum Padapadme Tayo Sritva Pranamami Mohur Moho. May Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, and Swami Vivekananda bless us all with bhakti, jnana, viveka, vairagya. Jai Ram Krishna.